You'll stay and enjoy the fresh blowing of the Spirit in this place.
Amen.
And I didn't mean for that to be a play on words, but a reality that the Spirit is here, that He's promised to meet with us. And if we open our hearts and our minds to receive all that He has for us today, we will receive it and we will walk away blessed and refreshed from the activities that go on today. We have been speaking in recent weeks about the pilgrimage festival of unleavened bread and of the bread from heaven and of the meaning of all those things. And we've come to realize that Father has placed within this first festival season of the year a picture not only of what He did for our ancestors in the past, the deliverance, the salvation out of Egypt, the baptism through the Red Sea, and the way that He cared for His people in the wilderness. But He's also put within that framework a picture of what's coming, what is ahead for us. And that is another salvation, the salvation which is the redemption of our bodies. And baptism is a picture of that salvation. It's a picture of what He's done for us in the past and a picture of what is coming in the future. And so the salvation work of the Almighty is ongoing. It's an ongoing thing, and we can continue to walk in it. We can continue to receive the blessings. We can continue to know and understand in a deeper way the things of Yahuwah, so that we can please Him in all that we do. Not to say that we shouldn't take what He speaks to us at face value and do it, even when we don't understand. We need to always be willing, with a heart open, to obey His instructions, even when we don't understand them. And oftentimes, I know this is the way it is with the Sabbath day, when before we keep the Sabbath day, we don't understand it, and so we don't really, it's kind of hard to get into that mode where we're seeing the Sabbath day as the will of Elohim for our lives. We see it in the past, in the days of Israel, ancient Israel, and how that He gave them the Sabbath day. But in our day, we sometimes think that the Messiah has replaced those things, and they're no longer relevant. And so we find it difficult to walk in the Sabbath day and to keep the commandments regarding the Sabbath. And yet when we do by faith step out and begin to honor the Father by keeping this day set apart from the other 6 days and not doing our own work or doing our own thing, then He gives us insight and understanding. The more we walk in this path, the more we understand why it is He gave it to us. And it becomes a thing that brings blessing and more blessing. And then even more blessing, the more we walk in it. He continues to fill us up. And our understanding of the Sabbath, whereas in the beginning it was, let me just describe it as this much. The more we do the Sabbath, the more we begin to understand it, that it's more than, it was more than just that. It was this, and it's this, and it keeps expanding in its meaning and its significance for us and in our relationship with the Almighty. And so it is with all the commandments, that when we walk in them instead of doubting them, instead of questioning them, when we walk in them, whatever understanding we didn't have, He will give it to us, and then we'll know why it is that He gave us those instructions. We find out that all those things are for our good, and for our life, and for our health, our well-being. So we've been talking about unleavened bread, and getting rid of the leaven out of our lives, the old ways, the ways of darkness that we used to walk in, coming into His light, and as children of light, and doing the things that please Him instead of the things that please our flesh and the things that please the world. And so today we're going to continue in the same vein of Vayikra, Leviticus 23, where we've been looking at these appointed times. And we're going to look at what's next on the calendar. And the title of the message today is Counting the Biblical Way. Counting the Biblical Way. We're going to learn in, I don't mean to be sarcastic or condescending. We're going to learn how to count to seven. And we're going to learn how to count to 50. And we're going to learn how to count to three. Because all those things, as you see, as the teaching develops, you'll see that they're all related to one another. So we're going to learn the counting. And we begin in Vayikra, or Leviticus, chapter 23 again, and verses 9 through 11. Here it's describing what happens next after the pilgrimage feast of unleavened bread. It says, Yahweh said to Moshe, speak to the sons of Israel and say to them, when you enter the land I am going to give you and you reap its harvest, bring to the priest a sheaf of the first grain you harvest. He is to wave the sheaf before Yahuwah, so it will be accepted on your behalf. The priest is to wave it on the day after the Sabbath. So there's a couple of things that are going on here, and we're going to break this down as we move along. There's the when you enter the land, because they couldn't very well reap a harvest out in the desert. So when Father gave them the land of their inheritance and they began to farm it, and it received the blessing of rain and sun in their seasons and produced a harvest, then when they reap that harvest, the sons of Israel were commanded to bring in a sheaf of the first grain. And the word sheaf there is the Hebrew word omer. It's an omer. It's like a small bundle of grain on the stalk. So you bring to the priest waves this sheaf, this omer, of grain on its stalk before Yahuwah, so it will be accepted on your behalf. It's your present to the Almighty. It's your way of saying, thank you for the harvest. And I acknowledge you, Father in heaven, as the one who brought about the harvest. It is because of your goodness and your kindness that I even have this food to eat. And so I present the very first stalk of this harvest to you to say thank you. The priest is to wave it on the day after the Sabbath. And so we're going to look at a couple of those things, especially the day after the Sabbath. But let me read on. Verse 12, on the day you wave the sheaf, you must sacrifice as a burnt offering to Yahuwah a lamb, a year old without defect, together with its grain offering of 2/10 of an ephah, a fine flour mixed with oil, an offering made to Yahuwah by fire, a pleasing aroma, and its drink offering of 1/4 of a hin of wine. You must not eat any bread or roasted or new grain until the very day you bring this offering to your Elohim. So in other words, before you jump in and start enjoying the harvest for yourself, you offer that first portion to the Father to say thank you and to acknowledge Him. This is to be a lasting ordinance for the generations to come in all your dwelling places. And again, this word ordinance is a chukah. It's not a mishpat, it's not a judgment, but it's a everlasting law that we're to commit to do these things. And so offering up this first bundle, this omer of grain from the field, is a law throughout all your generations, it says in the Hebrew, and in all of your dwelling places. In another translation, it says, wherever you live. So, yeah, wherever you live, in all your dwelling places. So, in other words, this law was given to the sons of Israel. And although it was initiated when they went into the land and began to harvest their own grain from the field, it's to be a lasting law for Israel. So that wherever we live, even in the dispersion, the diaspora, or the exile, which we are in, and we are the sons of Israel. One of these days I'm going to bring about a teaching. Maybe I'll, we'll talk about who the sons of Israel, who is Israel. And I think you're going to come to see, because of the flow of Scripture and because of what Paul says in the New Testament, that we are Israel, that we've been grafted in. Okay, so there I've given you already a preview of what's to come. We are Israel. We are the sons of Israel. We receive the promises that were promised to the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Jacob being Israel, and the sons of Israel. And so all of those things that Father promised are going to come upon us who are connected to the seed of Abraham, who is Messiah. Messiah is the seed of Abraham. Messiah is the rightful heir of the inheritance. And we belong to Messiah, and so therefore we are going to participate with Messiah in that inheritance as the sons of Israel, as fulfilling the promises made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So this is why that wherever we live, as the sons of Israel, we're to honor the Father with the first fruits of our harvest, with the first fruits of what He enables us by His own power to have and to receive. Counting to 50, from the day after the Sabbath. This is continuing on in Leviticus 23, verse 15. From the day after the Sabbath, the day you brought the sheaf of the wave offering, count off 7 full weeks. Count off 50 days up to the day after the 7th Sabbath, and then present an offering of new grain to Yahuwah. On that same day, you are to proclaim a set-apart assembly and do no regular work. This is to be a lasting ordinance for the generations to come, wherever you live. And so when we count off those 7 weeks and then add a day to the day after the Sabbath, we come to the first day of the week. It's a Sunday. And this is more commonly referred to as Pentecost. But in the Hebrew, it's Shavuot. Shavuot in Hebrew means 7 or week. Shavuot is just the plural of week or weeks. And so this pilgrimage festival is called the pilgrimage of Shavuot or week, 7 weeks. We count 7 weeks, and then the day after the 7th Sabbath is the day that we proclaim a set-apart assembly, and that would be Pentecost. A lot of important things happened on Pentecost, some of which we're not going to really go into today. But it's important that we get the right day and we have the right counting, that we have the right measure for counting. Because over and over again, we mentioned this during the Pesach celebration, there's an expression that occurs over and over, and it says, on this exact day. On this exact day. And that expression occurs here again with regard to Shavuot and with regard to the first day of the counting, the day when we offer the Omer. We give it to the priest and he waves it before Yahuwah. So each one of these days has to occur in exactly the right time, or we miss the time, we miss the appointment, and we miss the point of what the Almighty is doing to teach us about His redemption. Okay, so let's go back to some basics. The word translated sheaf in our text is from the Hebrew omer. And the word means a sheaf, figurative of food. I guess this is one of the Hebrew lexicons, so I just cited it here. It's a measure, an amount measured, and it equals a tenth of an ephah, which we saw in Exodus chapter 13, I believe it was. We read that the last verse of that chapter said, an omer is one-tenth of an ephah, which didn't help us because we don't measure in omers and ephahs, so we're still kind of left in the dark. But it's a measure. The omer is the first sheaf of the spring harvest, which is brought to the priest and waved before Yahuwah. So keep in mind that the omer when they gathered the manna in the mornings while they're in the wilderness, each one gathered up an omer. It was an amount. It was a bundle. It was a certain measurement of what they needed for the day, the food that they needed for that day. And so the omer is a sheaf. The omer is not always the same measurement. You can imagine going out to the field and chopping off and lopping off some grain, you know, the stalks of the grain. And one time, you know, when you gather it, it'll be this much. And you move along and you chop off the next bunch and it'll be this much. And so it's always a little different. But that's still an omer. It's the bundle of the grain on its stalk. So that's why it's kind of hard to say exactly what an omer is. It's because it changes a little bit. It fluctuates a little bit. So what day is it that we're supposed to bring this grain offering to Yahuwah, to the priest? Now this text immediately follows the instructions regarding the Feast of Unleavened Bread and its set-apart observances. So the question which is frequently debated is that of when this sheaf is presented and weighed before Yahuwah. And the reason we bring this up is because there are several different opinions about what day this was. It says the day after the Sabbath. But that could mean different things to different people, and it does mean different things to different people. But we're going to look at that, and we're going to kind of overview that, what the various sects of Judaism believe it is, and then we're going to try to break it down from the scriptures itself and try to come to some understanding about what day that is. So in the first century, various sects such as the Sadducees, both the Essenes and the Essenes, who lived in the Dead Sea area, the Qumran area, and later the Karaites, had a disagreement with the Pharisees, who are traced today to Rabbinic Judaism, on when this day of the waving of the Omer was. So we have, five different groups here: the Sadducees, the Bothusians, the Essenes, the Karaites, and the Pharisees. They're all different sects of Judaism. The Karaites, well, you know much about the Sadducees and Pharisees from what the New Testament says about them. The Essenes were little known except by the Qumran Dead Sea Scrolls. We learned a lot more about the Essenes. They were just another sect of Judaism. They had their own laws and ways, you know, of conducting their religions. The Bothusians, I'm still in the dark about who they were. The Karaites are a group of people that have sprung up in resistance, in kind of a response to their disagreement with Phariseeism, which is Rabbinic Judaism of today. So Phariseeism was the beginning of Rabbinic Judaism, the rabbis, and all of their laws, all of their oral Torah that they added to, and which, by the way, displaces the commandments of Elohim. So Rabbinic Judaism is really just another religion. It's not really biblical. It's based on the Bible. It's based in the Torah of Scripture. But the way it's conducted is not biblical, because they put human tradition and the opinions of rabbis and the practice of rabbis above what the Word itself says. So in effect, as the Messiah said, you nullify the Word of Elohim by your own traditions. He said that, I believe it was in Matthew chapter 15. And so Rabbinic Judaism, which is modern-day Phariseeism, is just that. It's just another religion that claims authority, and they have their arguments why they have authority to do these things. And yet when you break it right down, the Messiah resisted them at every turn. And we too are to resist the teachings, the leaven of the Pharisees, because that leaven of the Pharisees, their teachings, will lead us astray from obedience to the word of Elohim. So anyway, all five of these different groups kind of had different ideas about when the beginning of this count was to occur, because there's a little bit of vagueness within Vayikra 23 about when it was to occur. The Bothusians were considered a sect of the Sadducees. They received their name from Simeon ben Bothus, who was appointed high priest by Herod the Great in 24 before the Common Era, according to Josephus in his Antiquities. The Sadducees, Bothusians, and Karaites maintain that the counting of the Omer should begin the first day following the weekly Sabbath. Okay, so there's one method of counting. The Essenes believed it started on the Sunday, the first day of the week, after the end of the entire eight-day festival, 1 week later than the Sadducees, Bothusians, and Karaites. And when the text here, what I read from the lexicon said the eight-day festival, they're including Passover as another day of the festival, although technically it's not. The 14th of the month is not a part of the seven-day festival of unleavened bread. So bear in mind that sometimes the things that we read, the information we get, is a little bit tainted by the tradition and by the interpretation throughout the centuries of how men viewed these things. The Pharisees, or Rabbinic Judaism, maintains that the counting should begin on Aviv Nisan, the first month of the year, Aviv, also called Nisan, 16, which is the day following the first day of unleavened bread. Okay, so who is right? In one sense, the first day of the Pilgrim's Festival of Unleavened Bread is a Sabbath day, because we're not to do any work on that day. But we're to observe, you know, a holy Shabbat, as it were. And so this is why the Pharisees believe that the counting begins on the day after the first day of unleavened bread, or the 16th of Aviv. We're going to see some problems with that. The whole argument hinges on the meaning of Shabbat, believe it or not. It hinges on the meaning of Shabbat, since the waving is to occur on the day after the Shabbat. The Pharisees and their successors, the Rabbinic Jews, propose that the Shabbat can refer to the seventh-day Sabbath, or to the high set-apart days, or to a set of 7 years. And therefore, they believe that the first day of unleavened bread is this Sabbath, the day after which the offering is to be presented and waved. And thus, they come up to the 16th day of Aviv as the day of the wave offering. And so, again, there is a sense in which the first day and the seventh day of unleavened bread is a Shabbat, because no work is to be done on these days. But let's look a little deeper into the problem with this theory. The problem that is, and I put it kind of simply, and I hope this isn't condescending either, but that it's not supported by Scripture, at least in my opinion. Okay. But then there are a lot of teachings of the rabbis that are not supported by Scripture. And we find a real pattern there of the teachings of the rabbis of Rabbinic Judaism not being supported by Scripture, but being additions to the Scripture and interpretations of the Scriptures which are not valid because they don't allow, because in their application, many of these interpretations of the rabbis cause us to disobey the very commandment that Elohim gave. I mean, that's the bottom line, is that they're at odds with the plain and simple reading and understanding of an instruction of Scripture. The form of our word, and here's where we really get down to it, the form of this word, Shabbat, in Vayikra, Leviticus 23:15, is Ha-Shabbat. The Ha, the He at the beginning of the word Shabbat, is the definite article. It just simply means the Sabbath, Ha-Shabbat. In this form, HaShabbat occurs 17 times in the Torah, including in our text. And every time this word, let's set our text aside just for a second, every other time this word is used in this form as HaShabbat, it is referring to the weekly seventh-day Sabbath day. Every time. HaShabbat always means the seventh-day Sabbath. HaShabbat does not refer to the first day of a festival season, even though those are times of rest. And so here are the references. They're in Exodus a number of times, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. So here throughout the Torah, HaShabbat in that form is always referring to the seventh day Sabbath. In the rest of the Tanakh, or the rest of the Old Testament, the same is true. A total of about 40 times the form of the word HaShabbat is used in the Tanakh, the Old Testament. HaShabbat always refers to the weekly Sabbath, and so therefore, in our passage here in Vayikra 23, why wouldn't it also refer to the weekly Sabbath? If every other time throughout all of the scriptures, HaShabbat always refers to the seventh day Sabbath, and not a special feast day Sabbath, then why wouldn't it also refer to the seventh day Sabbath here? And we're going to see that it makes better sense when we start doing the counting. Okay, furthermore, the word Shabbat without the definite article also always refers to the weekly seventh-day Sabbath, except where there are other modifiers to further define its meaning. An example of when Shabbat does not refer to the seventh-day Sabbath is here. In Vayikra 25, verse 8, count off seven Sabbaths of years. So here the Sabbaths are yearly Sabbaths, or a set of 7 years. The seventh being the Sabbath year, if you will. 7 times 7 years. So that the 7 Sabbaths of years amount to a period of 49 years. So here we have the additional modifiers, the word years, to clarify what the Sabbath is referring to. It's a Sabbath of years. And here, the word Shabbat is in the plural, or Shabbatot, and it explicitly calls this time period Sabbaths of years. The modifier of years lets us know that these Shabbats are not the weekly Shabbats, but are referring to a different kind of Shabbats. And so that's the only exception to the rule of what Shabbat means in the scripture, is when it has a modifier like it does here, when it's called the Shabbat of years. So the next question that needs to be addressed is which Sabbath? I think we understand then that it's the seventh day Sabbath that's being referred to, and therefore the day after the seventh day Sabbath is when the sheaf is to be waved by the priest. That would be the first day of the week, which we call Sunday, and which is why Pentecost, at least in the Christian world, is always on a Sunday, right? Isn't it? Where you come from, some denominations celebrate Pentecost with more zeal than others, but wherever it is celebrated in the Christian church, it's always on a Sunday. So the next question is, which Sabbath? And Leviticus, Vayikra 23, 9 through 11, is a little vague to identify which Sabbath the sheaf is to be waved. It says this in verse 11, he is to wave the sheaf before Yahweh, so it will be accepted on your behalf. The priest is to wave it on the day after the Sabbath. Okay, so the question arises, what Sabbath is this referring to that the sheaf needs to be waved? Of the more common views, the Essenes believe that the Sabbath after the conclusion of the Feast of Unleavened Bread was the time of this offering. The rest believe that the Sabbath being referred to is the one which the day after is one of the 7 days of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So it kind of doesn't make sense that we would wave this sheaf after the 7 day festival was over. Because we're going home by then. Our ancestors were going home that next day because the 7 days were over, the feast was over, and people are going back. They need to get back to business. And so the view that the Essenes took, that it was the counting would begin and the sheaf was to be waved after the 7 days, kind of doesn't make sense, especially in light of what I have written here on this slide. Why were people commanded to go up in the first place? Why is it that 3 times a year we are all commanded to go up, to present ourselves to Yahuwah? The purpose of the going up was to present yourself to your Elohim. It was to appear before him and to bring in the gift. a gift from the field to say thank you. You are not to approach him empty-handed. It says this over and over in the Torah, that no one is to appear before him empty-handed. You don't come with nothing to offer. What would be the point of coming up and saying thank you to him and not having some tangible way of expressing that, the true thanksgiving, by means of, you know, presenting that first bundle of the grain that was harvested. And therefore, this approaching the Almighty was done sometime during the 7 days of the pilgrimage festival. Because that was the purpose of the 7 days. It was to come before him. And so it makes perfect sense that the grain offering, this first fruits offering, was offered sometime during the 7 days. And not before and not after. But it was in fulfillment of the purpose of those 7 days that we would give the priest the first sheaf of our field and he would wave it before Yahuwah. The first day of the week had to fall among the 7 days of unleavened bread. So the question, one time in seven, depending on what day of the week, is the 15th day of the month of the Aviv. It could fall on any one of the 7 days of the week. Six of those 7 days, the day after the Sabbath, it was still going to fall during the 7 days of unleavened bread. But in one, there's one exception where the day after the Sabbath day, the Sabbath day is not part of the 7 days of unleavened bread when it refers to the day after the Sabbath day. So we need to keep that in mind as well. What's important is that the waving of the offering was done during one of the 7 days. So if the waving of the offering was done on the first day, or the 15th day of Aviv, the first day of the 7 day Feast of Unleavened Bread, then the Sabbath, the day before, was not part of that 7 days of unleavened bread. So that's the bottom line, is that it was always offered during the 7 days, the day that follows the Sabbath. And hopefully that clarifies things, because you're going to hear some groups that do it a different way. They do it the Essene way, where they wait until after the 7 days is over, and then they believe that that's when the wave offering occurs, and then therefore when the counting occurs or begins. But it's important to get their day right, because if you wait until after the 7 days of unleavened bread and you begin to count, then you're going to come up, then Shavuot or Pentecost is going to come a week later than when everyone else is doing it. And again, we need to get the exact time. And we're basing this on the Bible. And so let's move into Messiah as our first fruits. I think that should answer most of the questions about the counting. And therefore, we can count. We did the Passover celebration Friday, April 19th. And then that Saturday, or the Sabbath day, April 20th, was the first day of unleavened bread. And then the day after that, April 21st, was the day when the wave sheaf was to be offered. Although we don't have the means to offer that grain offering for a number of different reasons. Nevertheless, the counting begins on that day, and so we can count forward 7 weeks of seven. Let me say this too, because I think I missed this point. If we were to count 7 weeks of seven, but we were to begin on a day that was not the seventh day Sabbath, that first day, the 15th of Aviv, we could call that a Sabbath. But the following 7 days later, it's not a Sabbath anymore. And so we're not counting from Sabbath to Sabbath if we start our count from the 15th day of Aviv. Are you following what I'm saying? Because the 15th of Aviv could be regarded as a Sabbath, but none of the 7 days afterward, you know, as we count to seven and then another seven and another seven, none of those days are Sabbath days. They're just some day of the week. And so we're not really counting from Sabbath to Sabbath when we use the method of the 15th being the Sabbath that's being referred to. However, if we use the seventh-day Sabbath, then every seventh day is a true Sabbath. And so we're literally counting from Sabbath to Sabbath, seven Sabbaths, and then the day after that seventh Sabbath is the 50th day. So in the New Testament, Messiah is presented as our first fruits. And this is going to launch us into another aspect of the teaching on the first fruits and some more counting issues that we need to deal with. It says in 1 Corinthians 15, Messiah has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Messiah all will be made alive. But each in his own turn, Messiah the first fruits. And then when he comes, those who belong to him, and then the end comes, it goes on to say. So the Messiah was regarded as the first fruits of the resurrection. And this is an important thing because the first fruits is an important day on the calendar. It's about presenting back to Yahuwah what belongs to him as a means of thanking him for what he has given us. So Yahushua had to be presented to the Father on this day to be acceptable. Remember the first fruits offering, that sheaf was to be waved in order that you would be accepted before the Father. Because it's an act of righteousness. It's a commandment of Scripture. It's something that we're told to do. And so when we present to the Father our sheaf offering, the omer of grain, then that is for our acceptance. The Father sees it. He receives that genuine act of praise and thanksgiving. And he accepts us as belonging to him because we're fulfilling this commandment of Scripture. Messiah, it says, remember at his baptism, when John, Yohanan the Immerser, objected and said, I should be baptized of you, he said that it was important to fulfill all righteousness. And so Messiah, at every step of the way, he had to fulfill the Scriptures that pertain to him. He had to walk in righteousness and do all of the things that the Torah required of every man. And one of those things was to present a wave offering. So why, even though the Scriptures, the New Testament Scriptures particularly, do not say anything in detail about this first fruits offering, why would it seem strange to us? Because I know this isn't taught. You won't find this on the lips of any preachers, or most preachers, let me just put it that way. You won't find this teaching in any of the concordances or lexicons or commentaries about what the Messiah did, what Jesus did on the day of first fruits, other than, you know, the obvious thing of the resurrection event. But he came to fulfill all righteousness, and so as part of that righteousness, he would have had to present himself as a first fruits offering to the Father. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Because this is what every man in Israel did on behalf of his family. He presented the first fruits, waved it before Yahuwah. And so where the Bible does imply that the Messiah did this. And I'm going to show you something that you may have never heard before or seen before. But I think it's still valid because of this idea of him fulfilling all righteousness. So we're going to go back to the account in the book of Lazarus, or otherwise known as the book of John, the Gospel of John, and chapter 20. It says, early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark. And the reason I underline while it was still dark is because Miriam of Magdala went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. And so it was still dark on Sunday morning. The daylight hours of Sunday had not yet begun. And so when we count the days that he was to be in the tomb. We can't include Sunday morning because Sunday morning was not yet, according to this account. It was early on that first day while it was still dark. It was the dark part of the day and not the light part of the day when Miriam found the tomb empty. He wasn't even there anymore. And when we look through the rest of the gospel accounts, none of those gospel accounts tells us when he was resurrected. None of them say that he was resurrected on Sunday morning. We just make that assumption. But whenever the account talks about, the first day of the week, the tomb's already empty. And so it's up to us to determine in some other way when he actually was raised out of the tomb. And that's what I propose to do here. And we're going to count. We're going to count the 3 days and three nights. So it says, she saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. And so she came running to Shimon Kefa, or Simon Peter, and the other disciple, the one Yahushua loved. And that disciple?
Lazarus.
Is Lazarus, yeah. Lazarus was the disciple that Yahushua or Jesus loved. And it gives a very clear account of that in chapter 11 of this book. And if it repeats it over and over and identifies Lazarus as the one, this disciple that Yahushua loved. So she came running to Shimon Kefa and the other disciple, and she said, they have taken the master out of the tomb and we don't know where they've put him. Moving on, so Kefa and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Kefa and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but he did not go in. And then Shimon Kefa, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Yahushua's head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. And finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. And so the writer of this gospel keeps identifying himself as the other disciple or the disciple that Jesus loved. And so, probably as an act of humility, he didn't keep naming himself over and over. He didn't want to be the focus of the text of Scripture. But he wanted us to know that he was there, that he was that disciple. So he calls himself the other disciple. And so this other disciple saw and believed, whereas the rest of the disciples did not believe when they were first told that the Messiah had risen from the dead. And later on, he scolded them for their lack of belief. When he had the 12 or the 11 before him, it says he scolded them for not believing. But this disciple believed when he saw the empty tomb. They still did not understand from Scripture that Yahushua had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Miriam stood outside the tomb crying. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Yahushua's body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. And they asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my master away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." And at this, she turned around and saw Jesus, Yahushua, standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" And thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." And Yahushua said to her, "Miriam," and she turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher or rabbi. And Yahushua said, "Do not touch me." And there's the phrase I'm going to focus in on for a minute here. He says, "Do not touch me, for I have not yet gone up to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my Elohim and your Elohim." And so that's the end of the account as I'm going to delve into it. But where he says, "Do not touch me, I have not yet gone up to the Father," later on that evening, he told his disciples that they could see him and touch him. And so what was the difference between this early morning visit to Miriam, where he said, do not touch me, and later on that day when the disciples were allowed to touch him? And I would suggest to you that it's because when he said, I have not yet gone up to my Father, he had to present himself to the Father at the temple in accordance with the instruction of the Torah as a first fruits offering. And therefore, the first fruits offering was holy. We read that about it in the Torah as well. The first fruits offering is holy. And so he had to remain in a state of separateness or holiness following his resurrection until he presented himself to the Father. Now, the going up, what does going up refer to? We're told that 40 days later, he ascended up into heaven to be with the Father. And that is what he's referring to here when he said, go and tell my brothers, I'm returning to my Father and your Father and to my Elohim and your Elohim. And I suspect as he said this, I'm returning to my Father and your Father, my Elohim and your Elohim, that this was something that the Messiah said to his disciples that kind of uniquely identified him. Like it's not something that other people would say, you know, my Father and your Father, my Elohim, your Elohim. But it seems to have been uniquely an expression that he himself used. And therefore, when Miriam would repeat this phrase to the disciples, they would know that this was something that the Master had actually spoken. These were the words of the Master. So he did ascend 40 days later. The question is, did he ascend to heaven that morning and then return that day? What else could going up mean? What do you do? When you do these pilgrimage festivals, you go up to Jerusalem to appear before Yahuwah. There are psalms of ascents, Psalms 112 through 118. And then there's a whole bunch of other psalms later on, like 125. I'm guessing, I don't know the exact numbers of these psalms. But they're always introduced as a song of ascents. These songs of ascents were what the sons of Israel, when they were going up to Jerusalem, they would sing these songs. And so they were the songs of going up. They were the praises that they were reciting and singing along the way to appear before the Father. And so going up has this a more common usage as going up to Jerusalem or going up to the place of his presence. And so also when you present your offering, you go up to his presence. When you go up onto the Temple Mount, because the Temple Mount was raised above the rest of the landscape. And so again, when you walked up those stairs to present yourself to Yahuwah, you would be going up again. And so there's this constant talk of going up to present yourself before Yahuwah. And this is what I suspect the Messiah was referring to when he said, I have not yet gone up to the Father. He had to fulfill this act of righteousness, present himself to the priests, the very priests who killed him, who pronounced sentence on him, and as a testimony to them, he was to present himself as a first fruits offering of resurrection from the dead. And this would be a very impactful presentation if he were to go up, and he did. I suggest that he did. He had to. It was something that he was required to do, to present himself to the priest, the very priest that killed him, and, you know, 3 days later, there he is, presenting himself, you know. Showing the scars. You had me crucified, you know. I am the first fruits of the resurrection. And so I think it was very impactful for the priests. And we read later on in the book of Acts, chapter 6, verse 7, that many priests became obedient to the faith. And part of that testimony to the priests was this presentation of Yahusha, of himself, to the priest, to wave, as it were, to present this wave offering before the Father. And so there's no record of this found in the New Testament, but I believe that this took place. The testimony would have shocked the priests. And this was a testimony. Remember when Yahusha healed some people and he told them to go present yourself to the priest as a testimony to them. Remember that in the New Testament? So the presenting yourself to the priest, especially of a healing, if you were healed of a leprosy or of any disease, the Torah required that you present yourself to the priest. The priest would examine you and he would determine whether or not you were clean, that you were healed from that disease. And so the testimony that Yahusha told people whom he had healed was to go up to the priest and present themselves. And so he himself also presented himself to the priest as a testimony to them and as a fulfillment of the requirement of the Torah. So hallelujah, I hope that finds meaning for you, that even where the New Testament doesn't speak of the activities and the teachings of the Messiah, there are many things. In hyperbole, I think it was John who said, if everything were written, the whole world couldn't contain all the books that would be written, which is hyperbole. But the point is that there are many things that were not written, things that happened, and we can discern some of those things that had to happen like we just did, and realize that the Messiah did these things, fulfilling all righteousness. So now we're going to count to three. Because with this idea that the Messiah presented himself at the exact correct time, the appointment of the presenting of the wave offering, of this one who is the first fruits from among the dead. So how long was Messiah in the tomb? Because I mentioned earlier that Miriam found the tomb empty while it was still dark on the first day. So in all of the countings that we have to take that into consideration. The Messiah said he would be in the tomb 3 days and three nights. The traditional teaching says he was put in the tomb Friday evening and then raised the first thing Sunday morning. But that doesn't add up. The numbers don't line up. Because even if you included, you know, the last couple minutes of the Friday as a day, as a whole day, and then Saturday as a whole day, and then Sunday as one of the 3 days, even though it wasn't yet Sunday morning, it wasn't yet daylight, yet we still, traditionally, we want to add that as a day in the counting. You still only have two nights. And so, no matter how you look at it, it doesn't add up, the counting doesn't add up, that Friday evening he could have been put in the grave and Sunday morning raised. So let's break that down. In Lazarus, the book of John, chapter 2, on his first visit to Jerusalem during the Feast of Pesach and Unleavened Bread, the Pharisees asked him, "What miraculous sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all this?" And Yahusha answered them, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." And the Yehudim, the Jews, replied, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you are going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body. And after he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said, and then they believed the scripture and the words that Yahusha had spoken. Later on at his trial, this event is brought up again in the testimony that the false witnesses brought. In Matthew chapter 26, verse 60, it says, "They did not find any true witnesses to speak up against what Messiah had said, although many false witnesses came forward. And finally, two came forward and declared, 'This fellow said, I am able to destroy the temple of Elohim and rebuild it in 3 days.'" So this was the recollection of these false witnesses, because they didn't understand that he was speaking about his body temple and not the temple that Herod built. And then in Mark chapter 14, it kind of gives the same account Then some stood up and gave this false testimony against him. We heard him say, I will destroy this man-made temple, and in 3 days will build another, not made by man. And yet even then, their testimony did not agree. And of course, this isn't what he said, but this is the way they recalled it and reported it. They were false witnesses. Those who passed by as he hung on the tree hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the son of Elohim. And so we have these accounts over and over where people are repeating what they think they heard him say, meaning that it was well known what he said. The word got out what he said about rebuilding the temple in 3 days, although most of them didn't understand it. And then in Mark's account, those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, so, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, come down from the cross and save yourself. And that's not what he said either. He didn't say he was going to destroy Herod's temple. He said, if you destroy this temple, I will rebuild it in 3 days. He didn't say, I'm going to destroy Herod's temple, and then we'll rebuild it in 3 days. So again, these false witnesses don't know what they're talking about. But it still underlines the fact that the saying was well known. Or at least people, the way that people recollected that saying of Yahusha, that this was a genuine saying, that he was going to rebuild the temple in 3 days. Again, in Luke chapter 11, we're given further information about the 3 days and three nights. It says, as the crowds increased, Yahusha said, this is a wicked generation. It asks for a miraculous sign, but none will be given it except the sign of Yonah, or Jonah. Yonah being his Hebrew name. For as Yonah was a sign to the Ninevites, and so also will the Son of Man be to this generation. So the sign of Yonah was to be the same sign that the Messiah would declare. It would be a sign to the people. And that sign had to do with the 3 days and three nights. In Matthew chapter 12, he answered and said, a wicked and adulterous generation asks for a miraculous sign, but none will be given it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. And so now here in Matthew, he explains to us what the sign of Jonah is. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a huge fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. And so here, the sign of Jonah as being the authenticating sign of who the Messiah is has to be understood exactly. I mean, in terms of what Jonah was to the Ninevites. Because he was 3 days and three nights, not 2 days and one night or any other combination, but 3 days and three nights. And I'm going to make kind of a big deal about it because it is a big deal. Because we need to correct the things that have been taught us, the errors of interpretation, and the traditions that have led us away from an understanding of what really happened there at the cross and in the tomb and on the resurrection day. So the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. So in other words, there's a full 3 days and three nights when the Messiah would be in the heart of the earth, meaning the tomb or the grave. And so we need to do our counting to three with that in mind, that it's 3 days and three nights and not any other combination short of 3 days and three nights. But Yahuwah provided, and this is from Jonah chapter 1, verse 17, Yahuwah provided a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was inside the fish 3 days and three nights. And so there's the testimony of Jonah and the sign of Jonah. It was the 3 days and three nights. We're not going to leave this topic alone because it's talked about in a number of different places. And the importance of that is because this 3 days and three nights theme is repeated over and over and over and over again, we need to pay diligent attention to exactly what this means so that we can get the counting right, so that we can know when he was put in the grave and when he was raised from the dead. In Mark chapter 8, he then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed, and after three days, rise again. And he spoke plainly about this, and Kepha took him aside and began to rebuke him. So it was very clear, the Messiah taught very plainly to his disciples that it would be after 3 days that he would rise from the dead, after 3 days. Another important piece of the puzzle that we must consider. And he spoke plainly about this. It wasn't in parables anymore. It was just a simple, straightforward 3 days and three nights. Then again in Mark chapter 9, it says, they left that place and passed through Galilee. Yahushua did not want anyone to know where they were because he was teaching his disciples. And he said to them, the Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise. Another testimony that there was a full 3 days, and it was going to be after the 3 days that he would rise. So we need to reconcile that with all of these accounts of the 3 days and three nights. It says, but they did not understand what he meant and were afraid to ask him about it. Again in Mark chapter 10, yet another passage where he talks about this. He said to his disciples, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit on him, flog him, and kill him. 3 days later, he will rise. Matthew 27. This is after he was put in the tomb. Matthew 27, it says, sir, they said, we remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, after 3 days, I will rise again. So again, this testimony was very clear. Even to the unbelievers, they had heard the testimony. They were familiar with the testimony that after 3 days, he would rise again. So they said, give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he has been raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first. So here's what we need to reconcile. The phrases in 3 days, after 3 days, and 3 days later. How can all of those things be talking about the same time period? In 3 days, after 3 days, and 3 days later. And here is the beginning of how we work that out. It says that he told the Pharisees that if they had destroyed the temple, he would raise it again in 3 days. There's the expression, in 3 days. Next, he told the crowds in Matthew 12:40 that as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a huge fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. And then he told his disciples privately that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. So he would be raised in 3 days and after 3 days and would spend 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. So how does all that fit together? How can we reconcile that? The timeline that's popularly used, as I already alluded to, is that of Friday to Sunday, Friday evening to Sunday morning, which amounts to 1 day and two nights. Remember that Miriam found the tomb empty while it was still dark on Sunday morning. So there was only 1 day and two nights during that period of time between Friday evening when he was put in the tomb and Sunday morning when the tomb was found to be empty. So let's learn how to count to three. And again, not meant to be condescending or a put down, but we need to revisit this because we need to understand the reality and the perfect fulfillment that the Messiah brought to these prophecies he spoke. It can't be Friday to Sunday because it doesn't add up. If the tomb was empty before the daylight hours of the first day of the week, then he must have been raised before Sunday morning. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Is that logical? The tomb was empty, yes, even before the light part of the day, Sunday morning. So sometime before Sunday morning, he was raised. Here's the timeline that allows us to incorporate all of these expressions into one, the 3 days and the three nights. And that is a Wednesday death. If he died, if the Aviv 14 was on a Wednesday that week, the fourth day of the week, he would have been taken off of the cross and laid in the tomb before sunset that day, because they were, because that being the 14th day of the month, they were moving into the 15th day of the month, that sunset that evening. And they were interested in doing the Pesach, or eating the Pesach, which would have been the 15th day of the month. And so if they put him in the tomb near sunset on Wednesday evening. The three nights then we would count Wednesday night, all Wednesday night, all Thursday night, and all Friday night. Those would be 3 nights. The 3 days would be all day Thursday, all day Friday, and all day Saturday during the daytime hours of those 3 days. And so here, over this time frame, you have a full 3 days and three nights. He was raised, I'm suggesting, because it makes good sense of this time frame, that he was raised at sunset. At sunset, as Sabbath was coming to an end on Saturday evening. And therefore, Sunday morning, he wasn't there. Mm. That's exactly 3 days and three nights. Now, in Matthew's account of this time frame reckoning, very interesting selection of words is used here. And I want to bring that out to you, because not all of the accounts of the empty tomb, the finding of the empty tomb, are completely consistent with one another. In one of the accounts, it says that the day had already dawned, it was light. In the other account, in Lazarus, it said it was still dark. And so you have these discrepancies, these apparent discrepancies from the accounts given by the eyewitnesses. And we know that anytime eyewitnesses attest to something, their accounts are going to be a little bit different, because they see things from maybe a little different perspective. They sometimes remember things out of order and report things out of order. And, you know, I mean, that's a simple fact. In our courtrooms, the testimonies aren't always going to line up exactly. But that doesn't mean the witnesses are lying or intentionally deceiving. They're just recalling the events as they remember it and trying to give an accurate account. So in Matthew's account, in Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 and 2, very interesting selection of words here. It says, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, and I'm going to look at the word dawn there, the Greek word for dawn. Toward the first day of the week came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. And what did they find when they looked in? He wasn't there, right? So the angel rolled back the stone, but that doesn't mean that that's when the resurrection occurred. He was just rolling back the stone so they can look and see that he wasn't there. But at some point in time beforehand, he was actually resurrected. So this expression, in the end of the Sabbath as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, I want to look at that. The Greek word, which is translated here, as it began to dawn, and in another translation, at dawn, or as it began to dawn, I guess that's the same as the first one. It's the Greek te epiphoskese, tongue twister, te epiphoskuse. And I'm sure that doesn't have very much meaning at all to anybody, but there's an important thing that we're going to see about this word, epiphosko. The root word, epiphosko, from the Bauer, the BDAG lexicon, it means to grow toward or become daylight, to shine forth or to dawn or to break, like to draw on. And while it's not apparent from that definition, perhaps the final rendering of this word fits into our context as it began to draw on toward the first day of the week. So the word, literally, it comes from phosko, which means to shine. It's the light shining, it's phosko. And so epiphoske, epiphoskuse, is a word that refers to a drawing on or a shining forth. And now here's where it gets interesting. This word is only used one other time in the New Testament. And here's where we're gonna draw some meaning and make a conclusion about this word. That occurrence is in Luke chapter 23, verses 52 to 54. It says that this man, Joseph of Arimathea, went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus, of Yahushua. And he took it down and wrapped it in a linen cloth, and he laid it in a tomb cut into the rock where no one had ever lain. That was Joseph, right, of Arimathea. That was his tomb. It was the preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. And here's the expression here, epiphoskuse. The Sabbath was about to begin. Epiphoske refers to the time of transition at sunset from one day to the next, as it does here in this passage. It says it was preparation day, the day before the Sabbath, and the Sabbath was about to dawn or come upon them. And so it's referring to sunset, epiphoskuse. And so because it's very clear in this passage that this particular word, only used twice in the New Testament, it refers specifically to sunset as Sabbath was turning into the next day, then it's fair to conclude that Matthew 28 in this King James translation is accurate where it says in the end of the Sabbath, because that's what the Luke account uses, how it uses this word. At the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary and the other Mary and so forth, and the account continues. So Matthew seems to be suggesting that as soon as the Sabbath was over that evening, that they went to the tomb. And, of course, it would have been dark. It would have been still dark. And the angel of the Lord would have rolled back that tomb to show that he wasn't there. And so it appears from at least Matthew's account. And again, the other accounts don't always perfectly jive with this. But what they do tell us is that Sunday morning he wasn't there. And so we have to determine what point in time before Sunday morning he was raised from the dead. And Matthew's account seems to really give us the vital information we need to, at least with some certainty, draw that conclusion that it was Saturday evening, as Saturday was turning into the next day at sunset, that that's when he was raised from the dead. Giving us an exact 3 days and three nights, just as the Master had prophesied over and over and over again. So when we learn to count to three, and more importantly, we learn to be able to see through the traditions that have been passed on to us from our forefathers, the customs and traditions and beliefs that don't really add up, that don't really make sense of the text, but are based in some other reason for associating the Messiah's death and resurrection with some other deities that were worshipped back in the day, and the death and resurrection of those deities, it amounts to just another aspect of the syncretization of the true belief, what really happened with Messiah, kind of weaving it back into the false belief of how the nations honored and celebrated their gods and believed that their gods worked on their behalf. So I would suggest, as a conclusion to this study, that when we count to three, we realize that he was buried Wednesday evening, he was raised Saturday evening, and so for a full 3 days and three nights, and then after the third day, in other words, at the very end, as that third day was turning into the next day, after that third day, he was raised from the dead. So that fulfills everything he said. It would be in 3 days, it would be after 3 days, and it would be, what was the third one? Whatever that one was.
3 days later.
3 days later, yeah, 3 days later, thank you, John. So 3 days later, at the end of that third day, indeed he was raised from the dead. And so that's how we learn to count to three. So the counting is always important in Scripture as we're looking at the appointed times and as we're looking at the fulfillment of the appointed times. And our Messiah fulfilled the appointed times at the exact time. Even the prophecy that he gave about the sign of Jonah would be fulfilled precisely in 3 days, after 3 days. What was the third
three
one?
3 days later.
3 days later. I keep forgetting that one. So that was all fulfilled in that time frame of 3 days and three nights. And so we can take it to the bank that when we count correctly, we will be meeting with the Father at his appointed times. And then we will know and we will see the fulfillments of his redemptive acts at those appointed times. So again, the importance of the Moedim, the appointed times of Yahuwah, and why it's important for us to understand these things so that we can get a better understanding of what really happened and not be caught up in the traditions and customs of man-made religious systems. So that's what I have today. And I'm going to skip, at least for the moment, we'll see how much time we have afterwards. I want to move into a part of our service where I'm going to ask anybody who wants to be healed, who has a physical issue that needs to be healed, or an emotional issue that needs to be healed, an issue of what has been passed on to us, some generational thing which has locked into our lives, either consciously or unconsciously. If you can recall any of those things and you have a desire to be healed, please allow me and others to anoint you with oil. We'll call upon the Father according to the instructions in the book of James. We'll anoint you and lay our hands upon you. Let this be a time of healing where the Father's power can be displayed among his people. Because this is really what it's all about. The body is here for the proclamation of the truth. And the proclamation of the truth is hollow if it isn't accompanied by the true signs, the true power of Elohim in our lives. And so we look forward to the times when Yahuwah is going to reach out and touch us and heal us. So I open up the floor to you. If you have something to say in this regard, in regard to a testimony, and you want prayer and healing, please grab a hold of a microphone and let's proceed there. Is there anybody who wants healing today?